definition. Immune system is it is a protective system of human body to resist almost all types of infectious organisms or the toxins. Hello? Hello? That tend to damage the human body. It is called as immune system, the protective system that resist all types of infectious organisms, including toxins that may damage to the body. It is called as immune system. Okay, the immune system is a complex network of organs containing many interdependent cell types that collectively protect the body from bacterial, parasitic, fungal, viral infections, various toxins, and along with that the tumorous cells. Okay, so this is the complete definition that includes everything. Okay, so immune system is a complex network of organs containing many interdependent cell types. Okay, interdependent cell type is a keyword. Collectively, these are the various organs which are included in immune system: tonsils and adenoids, then the lymph nodes, lymphatic vessels, then the thymus, then axillary lymph nodes, then you can see the spleen, then inguinal lymph nodes along with lymphatic vessels, and the bone marrow. Okay, so these are the organs which are in the lymphoid organs. And the main organs of immune system, first and foremost is bone marrow, then second one is thymus, then spleen and lymph nodes. Okay, so the coming to the lymphoid organs, these lymphoid organs are responsible for production of lymphocytes and antibody, that means humoral immunity, antibody mediated immunity. Okay, anatomically the lymphoid organs are organized as a primary lymphoid organs and secondary lymphoid organs. The primary lymphoid organs consists of bone marrow and thymus. Okay, the stem cells which are present in a bone marrow, they either differentiate and give rise to B cells, or the precursors of the cells migrate to the thymus, and in the thymus they differentiate into various types of T cells. These B cells are responsible for humoral, that means antibody mediated immunity, and the T cells, these are responsible for cell mediated immunity. The secondary lymphoid organs, we have seen primary lymphoid organs and secondary lymphoid organs. In primary lymphoid organs, we have seen thymus and bone marrow. In secondary lymphoid organs, we have two types of lymphoid organs over here. Encapsulated, in that we have lymph nodes and spleen, which have proper capsulated organization as an organ. And uncapsulated, that means mucosa associated lymphoid tissue, the lymphoid tissue which is distributed throughout the mucosa, that can that comes under this unencapsulated secondary lymphoid organs. Each of these secondary organs is concerned with a different type of immune response. Okay, the lymph nodes deal with the antigens in tissue. For example, axillary lymph nodes deal with the antigens which are present in suet and the chest wall, etc. Okay, so the lymph nodes deal with the antigens in various tissues, right? Spleen deals with the antigens in the blood. Okay, so any antigen in the blood that will be dealt by spleen. Then MALT, that means mucosal associated lymphoid tissue. This system deals with the antigens at the mucosal surface, at the oropharynx, nasopharynx, gastrointestinal tract. All these tracts are provided with this mucosa-associated lymphoid tissue. Okay. So these are the secondary organs which are concerned with different types of immune response. This is the grammatical presentation, whatever we have seen.
ये नहीं मोटी वाली हो गई थी.
The bone bone marrow stem cell, it either differentiate into B lymphocyte or T lymphocyte. B and T lymphocyte, they migrate to a secondary lymphoid organs. Then this secondary lymphoid organs are either encapsulated or unencapsulated. Okay, so if encapsulated, then lymph nodes and spleen. If it is unencapsulated, then it is MALT, that is mucosa-associated lymphoid tissue. Okay, and each of this secondary lymphoid organ is related or responsible for certain type of immune response. For example, lymph node, it deals with the antigen in tissue. Spleen, it deals with antigen in blood. MALT, it deals with the antigen at the mucosal surfaces. Okay, so coming to bone marrow, all the cells of immune system are initially derived from the bone marrow, and the process is called as hematopoiesis. I think you must have gone through this terminology, hematopoiesis. Okay, during the process of hematopoiesis, bone marrow-derived stem cells differentiate into either a mature cells of immune system. That means if B lymphocytes are there, they mature inside the bone marrow itself. Some precursors, that means pro T cells, okay, they migrate out of the bone marrow, they travel to the thymus, and the maturation of T cells occurs in the thymus. Okay, so that means the maturation out of bone marrow occurs in the T cells. Okay, now in addition to red cells, hematopoiesis is the synthesis of blood cells that includes RBCs, WBCs, and platelets. Okay, so in addition to red cells, in addition to red cells and platelets, other cells are synthesized in bone marrow. These are B lymphocytes, natural killer cells, granulocytes. These granulocytes include neutrophils, eosinophils, and basophils, and immature thymocytes. Okay, these are also called as prothymocytes. Now, thymus, the immature thymocytes, which are also called as prothymocytes, they leave the bone marrow and migrate into the thymus. The function of thymus is to produce mature T cells. That means the maturation of T lymphocyte takes place in the thymus. Okay, after the maturation process, T cells that are beneficial to immune system, they are released in the blood, or they are spared, or they are stored. Okay, while those T cells which may evoke harmful autoimmune response that are eliminated. See, this is a very key step in which the T lymphocytes which are harmful to self antigens or self protein, these are destroyed. But the T cells which attack the foreign antigen or foreign, what do you say, a pathogen, they are stored or they are released in the blood. Okay, so that avoids the autoimmunity. And if this step is impaired, that may lead to the list of disorders which come under autoimmunity. Is it clear to you? So this happens in the thymus. Now, see, this is again the diagrammatic presentation of the same thing. In bone marrow, we have stem cell. That stem cell develops into lymphoid stem cell. That lymphoid stem cell develops into pro B cell and pro T cell. As we have seen, pro B cell will mature in the bone marrow itself. But the pro T
But the
cell
pro T cell
that will travel to the
that
thymus.
will travel to the thymus.
And here in
Here in
thymus,
thymus,
pro T cell
pro T
is
cell is
converted to immature
converted
T
to
cell,
immature T cell.
and then further it
Then further
differentiates
it differentiates it.
helper T cell,
For T
cytotoxic
cell,
T cell,
cytotoxic T cell.
suppressor T
And
cell.
suppressor T cell.
In bone marrow, the pro T cell, pro B cell, it is acted upon interleukin 7. This interleukin 7 is a stimulator which is secreted by the stromal cell that causes maturation of and pro B cell is converted to T cell. Hello.
No.
Can you hear me? Hello. So pro B cells in the bone marrow, they are converted to pre B cells. Okay, and the factor that stimulates the maturation of B cells is interleukin 7, which is secreted by the stromal cells of bone marrow. Then these pre B cells undergo proliferation, and the cells synthesized mature, but they are called as immature B cells, which have monomeric IgM and IgD molecules on their surface as a receptors. Okay, and at this stage, helper T cells, which are also called as CD4 T cells, they activate the immature B cells to convert it into a mature lymphocyte or a mature plasma cell to secrete antibodies. Okay, here you can see that this is an immature lymphocyte with IgM, monomeric IgM and IgD as a receptor. It is acted upon T receptor cell. It is called as helper T cell, which binds with CD40 receptor, which is present on an immature B cell, and this leads to the maturation of B cell into a plasma cell, and then the plasma cell start secreting or producing the antibodies. The antibodies produced are IgM, IgA, IgE and IgD. Okay, so this is the process of maturation of B cells particularly. Now coming to secondary lymphoid organs. First one and foremost important is spleen. The spleen acts as an immunological filter of the blood, and it is composed of the cells which are present in the spleen are B cells, T cells, macrophages, dendritic cells, natural killer cells and red blood cells. The macrophages and dendritic cells are called as antigen presenting cells. These are the cells which recognize the foreign antigen, and they present this antigen to the effector cells, that means the beta cells or T cells. An immune response is initiated. The macrophage or a dendritic, that means antigen presenting cells, present the antigen to appropriate B or T cell. In the spleen, B cells become activated and produce large amount of antibodies. We have seen it is a humoral type of immune response. Now, secondary lymphoid organ is lymph node. Okay, lymph node functions as an immunological filter of the body fluid. It is known as lymph. Okay. Lymph nodes are found throughout the body, and these are composed of T cells, B cells and dendritic cells. Then these are the cells of immune system. lymphocytes, T cells, natural killer cells, B cells, granulocytes or polymorphonuclear cells, then macrophages, dendritic cells. Okay. Coming to the lymphocytes, these are the WBCs and one of the body's main type of immune cells. They are made or they are synthesized in bone marrow and they are found in blood and lymph tissue. So basically these lymphocytes are present everywhere. T cells is a type of lymphocyte which develops in the thymus gland and plays a central role in immune response. Okay, cell mediated immunity is carried out with the help of T cells. T cells can be distinguished from lymphocytes by the presence of T cell receptors on the cell surface. There are three types of T cells. First one is helper T cells, which are also called as CD4 plus T cells. They help for the maturation of B lymphocytes. Then cytotoxic or killer cells, these are also called as CD8 plus cells. Cytotoxic T cells, okay, and the suppressor T cells. So these are major three subtypes of T cell. Then next one is natural killer cells, which are also called as NK cells. They have functions similar to CD8 T cells. They can recognize and destroy foreign cells, tumor cells, and some of the infected cells. They cause lysis of affected cell. B cells, the major function of B lymphocyte is production of antibody and in response to foreign proteins of bacteria, viruses and tumor cells. Okay, so the humoral immunity. Then granulocytes or polymorphonuclear leukocytes. Okay, these are the WBCs. There are three main types: neutrophils, eosinophils and basophils. Okay, these are predominantly important in the removal of bacteria and parasite in the body. Coming to macrophages, monocytes are the cells which are present in the circulation. When this monocyte migrate to the tissue, they begin to swell, they increase in diameter, and these cells are called as macrophages. So the monocytes which are present in the blood when they migrate to tissue, they increase in size and they are converted to macrophages. Okay, they are often referred as scavengers or the antigen presenting cells. They recognize the antigen and present this antigen to the effector cells. The macrophages secrete special activating substances which is called as interleukin 1 that promotes the growth and reproduction and further synthesis of specific lymphocytes. Then coming to the dendritic cells. Okay, dendritic cells also originate from bone marrow and function as a antigen presenting cells. These are more efficient antigen presenting cells than the macrophages. These are phagocytes in the tissue that are in contact with external environment. Therefore, they are located mainly in the skin, nose, lungs, stomach, and intestine. Okay, so the dendritic cells are the phagocytic cells which are in close contact with external environment. Okay. Now, coming to the theories of diversities of immune response. So the immunologist who put forward the theories of immune response need to solve the complexity of immune response in terms of specificity to millions of antigenic epitopes. That means our immune or human immune system is able to interact with millions of antigenic epitopes which may enter the human body. So the diversity of human immune response is tremendous. Okay, And second one is the bimodal immune response. A single antigen may lead to cell mediated immunity as well as humoral immunity. So these are the basic complexities which are taken into the account. So first and foremost theory is a side chain theory. So the Paul Ehrlich, he suggested that the surface of WBC expresses a variety of side chains, which are called as receptors, that form chemical link with the antigen. That means the side chains or receptors which are present on the WBCs, they form a link with antigen. Okay, so there are few receptors or the few side chains which are already present on the surface of WBC. At least one of these side chains will bind to given antigen, whichever antigen is introduced in or it has accidentally entered the human body. It binds with at least one of the side chains which is pre-existing on the surface of WBC. Okay, and that will stimulate the cell to produce more of these receptors. And these side chains are released in the blood as antibodies. Okay, the information of synthesis of side chains or the receptors, okay, which are present on the WBCs, this information is present in the genes. Hence, this theory is also called as germline theory. But this theory fails to explain the antibody synthesis against chemicals and the diversity of immune response. As there are selected or a few number of side chains or receptors which are present in the on the surface of WBC, this theory cannot explain the synthesis of diverse or millions of antibodies against the antigen. So the diversity cannot be explained on the basis of this side chain theory. Similarly, if the antigen which has entered the human body, if it is a chemical, then this theory again fails to explain the antibody synthesis against the chemical. So this theory was rejected. The first theory is side chain theory. Now, second theory is instruction theory, or it is also called as template theory. The Linnaeus Pauling in 1930s suggested a theory in which antigen itself act as a template around which antibodies fold themselves and assume the configuration complementary to any novel antigen. That means this theory suggests that antigen itself act as a template and the antibodies themselves arrange themselves and fold themselves to assume the configuration complementary to antigen. Okay, so the antibodies here assume tailor-made specificity and there is no need of germline information. Okay, so folding and arrangement of or configuration of antibodies on the template of antigen. Okay, but this theory fails to explain increased rate of production of antibodies. Okay, when first antigen is introduced, then there is a synthesis of antibody, but the increased rate of production of antibodies further, this cannot be explained with the help of this template theory of instruction. Okay, then improved quality of antibodies. Subsequent production of antibodies is more specific than the initial one. Okay, so this theory fails to explain the improved quality of antibodies. Okay, and third thing, that is memory response or memory cells. Okay, this cannot be explained with the help of this template thing. Then the third theory is selection theory. The Scientist Jern put forward the selection theory, suggested that initially a small number of antibodies are present on lymphocytes. When an antigen binds successfully to an antibody on the lymphocyte, it triggers the lymphocyte to secrete large number of antibodies. So the selection theory explains the increased production of antibody. It again explains the better quality of antibody production, but it is unable to explain the diversity of immune responses, as the antibodies which are present or pre-existing on the lymphocyte, the number is limited, and this theory cannot explain the diversity of immune response. So the last and accepted theory is the clonal selection theory. The scientist M. Jern, D. Tolmaid and M. Burnett, the three scientists, combined the theories of Ehrlich and Jern and modified it as a clonal selection theory. Okay, so this theory explains the extremely diversified immune response. There is a germline rearrangement of the antibodies which are present in the lymphocytes, okay, on the surface of lymphocytes. Then generation of immunological memory. Some of the cells undergo the they enter the G0 phase of cell cycle, and they stay as a memory cells. Whenever in future the same antigen happens to enter the body again, this immunological memory takes part and it takes over the immunological reaction. Okay, then bimodal immune response. Humoral as well as cell mediated immunity can be explained with the help of clonal selection theory. Now, amplification of immune response. Once a particular lymphocyte binds with a particular antigen, then the various cell factors which are secreted, they stimulate the particular lymphocyte to be converted into plasma cell to produce more and more antibodies. Okay, so this is amplification of immune response, and that can be explained on the basis of clonal selection theory. Okay, and last one is generation of effector cells and molecules. Antigen presenting cells identify the antigen and they present the antigen to the effector cells. For example, B cells, which converted into plasma cells to secrete the antibodies, and in T cells, or they present it to CD8 plus cells, or the natural killer cells. Okay, so these are the effector cells. So clonal selection theory explains all the phenomenon taking place in the immunological reactions. That's why this clonal selection theory is widely accepted. Now, coming to the innate and adaptive immune system. Okay, the immune system protects the organism from infections with a layered defense of increasing specificity. The most simply, the physical barriers prevent the pathogens such as bacteria, viruses from the entering organism. If a pathogen ruptures these physical barriers, then the innate immunity, which is called as natural immune system, provides an immediate but non-specific response. First and foremost thing is a physical barrier. After that, there is an innate immunity that provides immediate but non-specific response. However, pathogen successfully, if breaks the innate immune response, then the third layer of protection is adaptive immune system. It is activated by innate response. The immune system of the body is classified into the two types. First one is innate immunity and other one is adaptive immunity. Innate immunity is also called as natural or native immunity, which is non-specific. And the adaptive immunity is acquired and which is very much specific to the antigen. So these are the components of innate immunity. Humoral components, in that we have various enzymes, lysozymes, various peptides, beta defensins, then proteins of complement system which activate the cascade of reaction, then mannose binding lecithin, C-reactive protein and lung surfactant. These are the humoral components of innate immunity. Now coming to the cellular components of innate immunity, phagocytic cells, neutrophils and macrophages, the various epithelial barriers and natural killer cells. Okay, so these are the cellular components of innate immunity. Now coming to the adaptive immunity. The humoral component of adaptive immunity is various antibodies which are secreted by plasma cells, and the cellular components of adaptive immunity, helper T cells, cytotoxic T cells and suppressor T cells. Now coming to the innate immunity, which is also called as natural or native immunity. It refers to the defense mechanism that are present even before infection. Okay. Even before infection, the innate immunity works. Hence, it provides the immediate protection against the exposure of new pathogen. You can call it as a preventive immunity also. Such innate responses are not specific for a particular pathogen, but these are non-specific. So, not directed against specific invaders, but against any pathogen that enter the body. So this innate immunity is a first line of defense. The system does not confer long-lasting immunity of the particular pathogen. The defense mechanisms in this innate immunity, these are skin, chemicals present in the perspiration, then the skin oil, saliva, tears, hair in nostrils, cilia, mucus that clean out the debris from our lungs and trachea. So this is the first line defense. Inflammatory response, which is the dilatation of blood vessels and accumulation of WBCs at the site of injury, is one of the first responses of the immune system to the infection. The symptoms of inflammation are redness and swelling, which are due to increased blood flow of the tissue and extravasation of WBCs at the particular localized area. Okay, the fever, that is raised body temperature, also inhibits the growth of pathogen. So these all are the measures of innate immunity. Then coming to the types of innate immunity, two types, humoral and cell mediated. We have seen that, we are going to see it in detail. Okay. It an innate humoral immune system. It involves variety of substances found in the body fluid which protect against the extracellular microbes. So the innate immunity is responsible, or it takes care of extracellular microbes and their toxins. Okay. So certain natural chemical compounds which are present in the blood, for example, antimicrobial peptides such as beta defensins, which are present in skin, on skin and respiratory tract. The enzymes such as lysozymes, phospholipase A2, which are present in saliva, tear, breast milk, also antibacterial. In stomach, we have gastric acid and proteases. They serve as a powerful chemical defense against the ingested pathogens. And various plasma proteins which are present in a complement system. Yeah, they are also responsible for the killing of pathogens by antibodies. Then circulating proteins like mannose binding lecithin, C-reactive protein, they coat the microbes for phagocytosis and complement activation. And lung surfactant, which is again one of the important component of innate humoral immunity, providing protection against the inhaled microbes. Now coming to the innate cellular or humoral immune system, epithelial barriers, phagocytic cells, natural killer cells. Now coming to adaptive immunity, it consists of mechanism that are stimulated by microbes and also capable of recognition of non-microbial substances like toxins. Okay, and these are called as antigens. Adaptive immunity develops later after exposure to microbes, and it is more powerful in fighting the infections. The innate immunity is non-specific and pre-existing immunity, but adaptive immunity is specific immunity after the exposure of particular antigen. The types of adaptive immunity, say humoral and cellular, we are going to see in detail. Okay. When an antigen presenting cell presents an antigen to B cell, the B cell is signaled to proliferate and produce the antibodies specifically bind to that particular antigen. If antibodies bind to the antigen, it acts as a signal for polymorphonuclear cells or macrophages to engulf them and to kill them. Okay. Now coming to the cellular component of adaptive system, T lymphocytes that are specifically made in lymph nodes responsible for acquired cellular immunity. Antigen presenting cells present the antigen to T cells, and T cells become active and these are proliferated or differentiate into helper T cells, cytotoxic T cells, and killer T cells. Now coming to beta cell development, B cell development and formation of antibodies. Okay, so the B lymphocytes are the cells which form plasma cells, and plasma cells secrete the antibodies. Okay, the early development of these cells occurs in the bone marrow. And in the bone marrow, interleukin 7 is a signal that is secreted by stromal cells of bone marrow, and the pro-B cells start differentiating into pre-B cells. These pre-B cells undergo extensive proliferation and give rise to B cells which have monomeric IgM and IgD molecules on their surface. You can see this is the basic structure of immunoglobulin, which has heavy chains which are present in the center. They say given violet and pink color over here, and light chains which are given lemon yellow and green color. Okay, so this is the basic structure of antibody with two heavy chains and two lighter chains which are connected to each other at hinge region. They have antigen, it has an antigen binding site. It specifically binds with antigen. Okay. In addition to this IgD and Ig, IgM and IgD, there are some receptors on the B cells. These are complement receptors, CD21, Fc receptor, and CD40 receptor. The CD40 receptor is activated by the helper T cell. When net B cell reaches the secondary lymphoid tissue, they may be activated by protein or non-protein antigen. Activation of B cell require help from helper T cell, that is CD4 cell. It activates B cell by binding CD40 receptor, which is present on the B cell, and secretes the cytokines. These cytokines and these binding of T cells with CD40, these are the essential steps of B cell maturation, and they lead to the production of maturation of B cell to the plasma cell, and this plasma cell start secreting the antibodies. See, this is the dramatic presentation of all the steps which are which we have seen till now. Stem cell, lymphoid cell, pro B cell, pro T cell, pro T cell goes into the thymus. Same slide is repeated over here. B cell, by the action of interleukin 7, it is converted to pre B cell. It undergoes proliferation. An immature B cell is produced, which has IgM and IgD receptor on the immature B cell. It again has CD40 as a receptor that binds with T cell receptor of helper T cells, and that will lead to the maturation of B cell into plasma cell, and that will lead to the synthesis of various immunoglobulins. Okay. Now, B cell stimulation, the same thing over here is repeated. In the theory, we have seen this in this diagram, this pre B cell proliferation, immature B cell, when combines or when interacts with helper T cell, then it is converted to a plasma cell, and plasma cell secretes the antibodies. Okay. This is the activation of native B cells for the production of plasma cell. Here in this diagram, we have shown that how antigen is accepted and how this antigen is presented to the effector cells by the antigen presenting cells. Okay, this is a mature beta cell which accepts the antibody, or the antigen binds with the antibody which is present on the surface of mature B cell. After that, there is an endocytosis of receptor antigen complex. After the endocytosis, there is a fragmentation of antigen into various peptides and the synthesis of class 2 MHC glycoprotein. Okay, so this class 2 MHC glycoprotein combines with the antigen fragment and present it as a processed antigen, and then it activates the beta cell, and the beta cells start producing the particular antibodies. Okay. Again, this is the same diagram in which the antibody production from activated B cells. Here, the processed antigen displayed on MHC2 activated beta cells that binds with the helper T cells, and that leads to the production of antibodies. Each antibody is specific for particular antigen because its unique structural organization of amino acid in the variable portions of both light and heavy chains. Okay, there are two variable sites on illustrated antibody for attachment of antigens making antibody bivalent IgM, which consists of 10 light and 10 heavy chains, as many as 10 binding sites. See, this is a structure of antibody. In just 2 minutes, I will finish it off and we will continue in next lecture. I know it is quite saturating, but still just go through the structure of antibodies over here. Okay, this is IgG, which has two heavy chains and two light chains. IgE, similarly, two heavy chains and two light chains. IgD, two heavy chains and two light chains. Here is the IgM, which has 5 sublimates. Okay, and IgA, which has 2 sublimates. Immunoglobulins IgG, IgE, IgD have one basic unit, where IgM has 5 basic units and IgA has 2 basic units. IgM and IgA, they are connected by joining piece, which is called as J piece. Okay, so IgA is an extra secretory piece. Okay, so this is grossly the structure of antibodies: two heavy and two light chains over here. An upper part of the fork, they are called as highly variable sites. These particular sites bind with anti-J. IgM has 5 basic units, IgA has 2 basic units, and it is joined by J-piece. IgA is a secretory antibody. Okay, the details of antibody and the further syllabus of immunochemistry will be covered in the next lecture. Okay, thank you very much for bearing with me.
Mom.